The whole world right now is hit very hard by this pandemic situation, and especially Europe was and is still hit very hard. And for a period of time, countries were on lockdown, right, with borders closed. So I'm asking you, what was that mean for Frontex, for border control, especially for external border control?
Well, it was a unique situation in our history because officially all travels were suspended, which means that the number of travelers was reduced drastically. Only essentials, essential travels were allowed to the European Union. On the other hand, there are also irregular migration flows. And to a certain extent, we can say that they were suspended as well, because there was a lack of transportation means, and the country of transit, the country of origin, in many cases were also under lockdown, and there were travel restrictions. And the number of, airline companies operating was simply close to zero because everything was stopped. So that was a situation that nevertheless was not without challenges, and I would like to refer first to Greece. As you may remember, we had in the meantime, end of February, beginning of March, we had the beginning of two developing crises in parallel. We had the statement made at the highest level in Turkey saying that the borders were open for the migrants who wanted to go to the European Union. And you may remember that Greece requested support from Frontex and the European Union. And I decided to activate rapid border intervention at the land border, so rapid border intervention EVROS, at the land border between Greece and Turkey. And I also activated rapid border intervention AEGEN at the maritime border between Greece and Turkey. This was strongly supported by the EU institutions and all member states of the European Union and Schengen associated countries. We had all member states contributing to our operations, and we had, even during the worst part of the COVID-19 restrictions, we had 600 border guards or coast guard officers deployed in Greece, which means that during these pandemics, we had to invent quickly new ways of deploying our staff. Just an example, we had to deploy hundreds of border guards from the member states, from different member states, some of them from Romania, for example, of course. We had to deploy them to Greece. But how can we deploy staff when all the airlines stopped operating their flights? How can we deploy staff when there are quarantine obligations and restrictions? So we invented, together with the member states and the EU institutions, but with the member states, we had to agree on a kind of mutual recognition of the quarantine decisions. And we found an agreement so that our border guards first went in quarantine at home, and then we put in place flights, chartered flights, so that we could make sure that we could test that no border guard boarding our flights was infected, so that we were sure we could give the assurance to Greece that we deploy border guards and coast guard officers that are safe and healthy. So that's how we had to invent new procedures in order to overcome the pandemics and the difficulties. I can also give an example that, of course, safety first, and we had to make sure that our staff keeps safe. in the headquarters, but also, of course, at the external borders. At the external borders, we made a tremendous effort that was successful to purchase protection masks, gloves, sanitizing equipment, gel, so all the equipment. And we organized airlift to bring this equipment to Greece and to the other areas of deployment, such as Italy, such as Spain, to a certain extent, where we kept a certain operational footprint on the ground. When it comes to the standing corps, we were able to go on with the preparations. That's also because we, in the headquarters, we were able to maintain business continuity. Basically, in the first week of March, I activated the crisis management mechanism internally in Frontex. And then we shifted in the second week of March to teleworking. So massive teleworking. Here, I must say, I have to praise our ICT colleagues because they were able to maintain all the telecommunication. And we were able also to modernize certain process, shifting to digitalized process online. So in a way, I would say we learned a lot that will be, from a logistics perspective, will be very useful for the future European Standing Corps. So, for example, we created a technical hub at Thessaloniki Airport in Greece in order to store them the protection equipment for the border guards. We tested in real scale the massive teleworking, the business continuity plan, and we had only, if I may say, two infections among our staff, and this was at the very beginning. The first week of March, we had one confirmed case, then a second one, and this perhaps helped us to quickly and swiftly activate the business continuity plan. If we look at the economic impact of this, I read some surveys saying that the economic impact apparently is even worse than Second World War. I don't know, I'm not an expert in economics. But this shows that it's unprecedented situation. When it comes to border control, we see that there is something to do with mobility. The disease was spread, the pandemics was spread because of human mobility. Mm-hmm. And that's why most of the countries, all member states of the European Union, decided national measures on lockdown and travel restrictions. But of course, we cannot stay like this forever. And that's why now that there are relaxations of measures, we could witness that this was a successful approach because the number of infections was reduced, but we also have to be careful about what doctors say is perhaps coming, a second wave of infection. So we have to learn how to live, how to work, how to travel in such a situation when we have to cope for a long time with pandemics looming around. And if it's not COVID-19, could be another one. We just have to remember that Ebola was on the African continent, and Ebola is a serious threat on the African continent. So in a time of globalization, in a time when mobility is a fact, it's not just a matter of an opinion, do I like it or not, it's just a fact. We have to equip border management capacities. We have to set up systems that make it possible to mitigate the pandemic's risk. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying to stop it, but to mitigate the risk, to identify, to trace, and to mitigate. We are not a sanitary authority. We are not doctors at Frontex. We are border guards and coast guards. But if the doctors, if the sanitary authorities can tell us what we have to check at the border, what we have to do, then this would be the best way to make sure that we have long-standing methodology, reliable external borders, which is good for economy. Because the paradox, perhaps, well, I gave some interviews during the crisis, and some journalists were somehow joking and telling me, but you are missing open borders. And my reaction was, a border, this includes the external border, this is the point where people have to be let in and let out. So this is a filter. But the functioning of a border doesn't mean that people are not allowed to get in or to get out. It's simply that we have to make sure that people can safely get in and get out. And now this will include the sanitary dimension, should include the sanitary dimension.
So basically, that's another shift, another change in how you and local authorities will have to deal with stuff, because you work very close with national enforcement, right? And now you have to work with national sanitary authorities to establish protocols, right? Are these kind of protocols already in place in some places?
Well, we also work, because at European level, they are also agencies and authorities dealing with sanitary policies. Mm-hmm. So we are working with them. We are working on, procedures and how border control could take into consideration the sanitary risk and what kind of equipment we should have in order to, for example, put travelers in quarantine if needed. Mm-hmm. We also have irregular migration flows, and we have to also to think about this situation that, we will not stop irregular migration flows. We have to detect them, of course. We have to make sure that irregular crossings are intercepted, and then that people in need of international protection can have access to asylum, while other people who have no right to stay have to be returned. But let's be realistic. In April, we had only 900 irregular crossings reported at the European external borders, which was an unprecedented figure. Mm-hmm. Why? Because there was no global mobility, because half of the inhabitants of the world were staying at home, and there was no possibility to move around. But this is not a situation that we will have forever. So in a time when flights will resume, and it's now resuming, all kind of transport means will resume. Mm-hmm. So mobility will resume. Which means that irregular border crossing, irregular migration will resume again. And we expect a peak, because all the migrants that were stranded on their way to Europe, they will move on. So that's why we have to be ready also to handle properly the risk of sanitary or of infection, COVID infection among the migrants. Mm-hmm. Because people who are moving around, they could be irregular migrants or legal travelers. That's the same. People moving around, mm-hmm, can be infected. And this is...